Radio Corporation of America presents What's New with your host, the noted motion picture director and producer, Cecil B. DeMille.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On this very first day of a new year, may I say, welcome to What's New. There's nothing like starting the new year in good company, as we started this evening. With Herbert Marshall, Lena Horne, Carlos Ramirez, Evelyn Keyes, Donald Morrison, Lieutenant General Ira Acre, who will speak from England, Lou Bring and the RCA Victor Orchestra and Chorus, Jim Ameche, and Jack Douglas.
How do you do, sir? My name is Jack Douglas. You're new around here, aren't you?
Yes, I suppose I am.
Well, as I was saying, my name is Jack Douglas. I didn't quite catch yours.
Didn't anyone tell you I'd be here this evening?
No.
Then you don't know who I am.
Don't tell me you're another one of Don Amici's brothers.
Jack, what's the matter with you? This happens to be one of the greatest producers in Hollywood.
He is?
Yes.
Well, how are you, Bing? But I'm just kidding. I know you're C.B. DeMille, the noted director, and I hear that you previewed your latest production, The Story of Dr. Wassel, and it's great. And just think, now you've discovered me.
Oh, have I?
Sure. Don't you specialize in those famous DeMille bathing scenes?
Yes, but you're one tub I can't use.
Mr. DeMille, you can't turn me down. Why, I'd be great in pictures. I could be a great lover like Charles Boyer.
You could?
Yes. Listen, come with me to Lockheed.
What's the matter with the Casbah?
They pay more at Lockheed.
I also do an imitation of Catherine Hepburn, too. Would you like to hear it?
No, Jack, no. I think we'd all just as soon hear Lena Horne in person. Because looking back over the past year in the music world, one of the nicer events was the rapid rise of this singing star of Victor Records, who is currently appearing in Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer's Thousands Cheer. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Lena Horne. Good evening, Lena, and welcome to What's New.
Thank you, Mr. DeMille.
Perhaps you should be welcoming me. You've been quite a frequent visitor here.
All right, then. Welcome to What's New.
Thank you, Lena. A song from Lena Horne is welcome enough for anyone. Especially Paper Doll, as she sings it now.
I guess I've had a million dolls or more. I guess I've played the doll game all and all. But I've just quarreled with you. That's why I'm blue. And now you've gone and left me, just like all dolls do. I tell you, girls, it's tough to be alone. It's tough to love a doll that's not your own. I'm through with all of them. I'll never fall again. This is what I'll do. I'm gone to buy a paper doll that I can call my own. A doll that other girlies cannot steal. And all those flirty, flirty gals with their flirty, flirty pals will have to flirt with dialects that are real. When I get home at night, he will be waiting. He'll be the truest dog in all the land. I'd rather have a paper doll to call my own than have a fickle-minded real live man. I'd rather have a paper doll that I can call my own, a doll that other girls cannot see. And all those flirty, flirty gals with their flirty, flirty sounds will have to flirt with dollies that are real. When I get home at night, we'll wait for you. He'll be the truest doll in all the land. I'd rather have a paper doll to call my own than have a fickle-minded real live man.
For what's new in South American radio, we turn to Donald Morrison, a young man who has the unusual distinction of having been a well-known radio performer in two languages and on two continents. Lately, he's been devoting much of his time to the Spanish language broadcasts produced by the Office of the Coordinator of Inter-American Affairs, Donald Morrison. Well, Don, what's the current status of broadcasting in South America?
Oh, they have all the latest innovations down there. They use all the newest products of RCA, that's RCA, the Radio Corporation of America. And just as we do here, they talk about this well-known American product as Lux Flacus.
Lux Flacus? What's that?
You should know, CB. You sell it every Monday. Lux Flacus is the way they pronounce Lux Flakes.
Ah, music to my ears. How about the music down in South America? What are the latest hits?
Well, right now, they tell me the most popular songs are Besame Mucho and Mamacita del Arma de Fuego, Baje ese Fusil.
Yes, I know about Besame Mucho, but what's that? That's what Carlos Ramirez is saying tonight.
Yes.
What is this Baje ese Fusil business?
You mean Mamacita del Arma de Fuego, Baje ese Fusil? That's pistol packing mama. Lay that pistol down. And if you want to know about phonograph recordings, I hear that the new big seller is El Disco Victor de Glenn Miller, Debe Ser Jalea, Porque La Conserva No Tiembla Del Mismo Modo. English translation, Glenn Miller's Victor recording of It Must Be Jelly, because jam don't shake like that.
Don, just what kind of work do you do on the South American radio?
Well, CB, I specialize in dialects, in the Spanish language.
Dialects?
Yes. You see, just as in this country, we actors are called upon to play parts in English with an Italian, Spanish, or French accent. But down there, I would impersonate American, English, French, or even Japanese characters speaking Spanish, each with the accent of his own language.
Sounds a bit complicated. Suppose you give us an idea how each of those characters sounds.
Well, first of all, when Spanish is spoken by a native of Buenos Aires, it sounds something like this. Los porteños hablan castellano con acento muy simpático, especialmente cuando dicen palabras como en la calle Cangallo se cayó un caballo, macanudo, che.
Spoken like a true gaucho.
And now, just to make things even, here's the way that same Argentine sounds when he speaks English. Señor DeMille, I know what you think is very comical, the way I speak your language, but when you come to visit me in Buenos Aires, I will have much pleasure to listen to you as you are killing the Spanish language.
Sounds very authentico. What next?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm quite sure you're all very familiar with the English accent. And that is to say, the way an Englishman speaks his own language. But here's the way he usually attacks the Spanish language.
Cuando un inglés habla español, es completamente diferente, porque siempre tiene su melodía inglesa. ¿No es verdad? Muchas gracias, amigo.
How about a Frenchman?
All right, a Frenchman. Alors, mesdames, messieurs, you are without doubt familiar with the way the French they speak English. But here is a Frenchman speaking Spanish. Wanda, yo estive, I'm going to say Argentina. Yo conocía varias personas de Francia que siempre hablaban español con acento francés. Vive la Francia.
Viva Donaldo. Procedo, si vous please.
In South America, there are many people who are coming from Japan. And they naturally are speaking the Spanish language with accent of Japanese. Also, begging permission to give a demonstration, please. Thank you. Es muy gracioso cuando habla japonés en español. Oh, sí, porque naturalmente usan acento japonés. Y eso resulta muy cómico. Oh, sí.
Oh, sí, yes. Oh, sí, very clearly. Go ahead, Don.
Well, here's the one I like best of all, C.B. An American trying to speak Spanish. You know, more or less the way our friend Jack Douglas might sound down there. Me parece que yo le siento más gracioso que yo le siento de un americano. Porque nunca abre la boca y siempre tiene mala pronunciación.
Thank you, Donald Morrison. And as a Jack Douglas trying to speak Spanish may say, Buenas no cheese. Hasta muy pronto. What's new for the days to come in television? Mr. E.W. Engstrom is going to tell us about something very new and very important. Mr. Engstrom is research director of the laboratories of the Radio Corporation of America. And he's now with Jim Ameche in New York. All right, Jim.
Mr. Engstrom, several weeks ago on this program, you told us about a new sensitive television camera. Now, is research doing anything equally important for television receivers?
Yes, definitely. We'll have larger pictures for one thing, probably up to 15 by 20 inches, maybe even larger.
Larger pictures?
Yes. Let me explain. Television pictures are produced as light images on the flattened end of a special cathode ray tube or kinescope. Large pictures mean large tubes made of glass. In order to make the picture grow larger and larger in size, we'd soon have tubes too large for a home receiver. Where television pictures about letter sheet in size are satisfactory, we'll continue to view them on the end of a kinescope. For larger pictures, we'll use our new method, a projection method.
You mean something like home movies?
Yes, very much the same. The television picture will appear on a screen. The screen will be a part of the receiver. The picture will be projected from an extremely bright image on a small kinescope. The projecting lens is very unusual. You see, several years before the war, we were working on the problem of projecting television pictures without any real success. One day, Mr. Landis, one of our opticians active in talking movie work at RCA Laboratories, said that he had an idea that he could adapt for television a then-new type of lens being used with very good results in astronomy. This new lens system, a Schmidt camera lens, had never been used for ordinary cameras or for projection.
What progress did Mr. Landis make?
One day, after much patient, painstaking work, Mr. Landis set up his lens system for test. The result was a very poor picture, but we were enthusiastic.
Well, I don't understand.
The picture from his first lens wasn't good, but a principle had been established, and that, in research, is important. This lens was much more efficient than the usual projecting lenses. This meant that we could have large, yet bright television pictures. So we then formed a research team, set up a laboratory, and before too long, we're projecting excellent television pictures. From that point, a tremendous amount of work has been done to make the lens system practical and to learn how to produce it in quantity.
Then, this is an instance where stargazing proved helpful.
Yes. This camera, first used for astronomy, showed us the way to large, bright television pictures for the home. Pictures so good that they will add much to our enjoyment of television.
Up from the land of romantic melody, has come Carlos Ramirez, a native of Colombia, a noted concert singer in our good neighbor countries. He's widely known here for his Victor Red Seal recordings. On What's New this evening, he sings the newest Latin American hit, Besame Mucho. Señor Ramirez.
Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Tengo miedo perderte, perderte otra vez. Quiero tenerte muy cerca, mirarme en tus ojos, verte junto a mí. Piensa que tal vez mañana yo ya estoy lejos, muy lejos de ti. Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Bésame mucho, que tengo miedo perderte, perderte otra vez.
Bésame mucho, each time I cling to your kiss, I hear music divine.
Quiero tenerte muy cerca, mirarme en tus ojos, verte junto a mí. Piensa que tal vez mañana yo ya estaré lejos, muy lejos de ti. Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Bésame mucho, que tengo miedo perderte, perderte, mi amor.
Bienvenido.
Muchas gracias, señor DeMille. I didn't know you spoke Spanish.
No, I've been taking lessons.
From Donald Morrison?
No, from Jack Douglas.
Oh, do you speak Spanish, Jack?
Sai, sai. Go ahead, Jack. Go ahead, say something.
La Cienega, La Brea, Las Palmas, Olivera, Los Feliz, Ventura, Santa Monica.
I thought you were going to say something in Spanish. All you did was mention the name of the street.
So what?
Where did you learn the Spanish? From school?
No, from my mother. She drives a taxi.
That was the worst Spanish I ever heard.
Oh, yeah? Well, just listen to this. San Luis Obispo. And don't forget, folks, San Luis Obispo spelled backwards spells Apsibo Tiol Nas. Sai, sai.
Well, Jack, for real Spanish, or Español Verdadero, just listen to Carlos as he sings the beautiful Amor, amor, Señor Ramirez.
Amor, 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 nació de ti, nació de mí, de la esperanza. Amor, 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 nació de Dios, para los dos nació del alma. Sentir que tus besos se quedaron en ti, igual que palomas mensajeras de luz. Saber que tus besos se quedaron en ti, haciendo en tus labios lo sería. De mí, de la esperanza. Amor, amor, amor. Nació de Dios, para los dos, nació del alma.
Amor.
De ti, nació de mí, de la esperanza.
El amor, amor, amor.
Nació de Dios, para los dos, nació del alma. Sentir que tus besos se quedaron en ti, igual que palomas mensajeras de luz. Saber que tus besos se quedaron haciendo en tus labios lo sería. De mí, de la esperanza. Amor, amor, amor. Nació de Dios, para los dos, nació del alma.
Ago today, on January 1st, 1942, the United Nations Pact was signed, making official the resistance of free peoples to access to aggression. On this anniversary, Jim Ameche is in a New York studio with some eyewitnesses of the Nazi terror that brought those United Nations into being. Come in, Jim.
Thank you, Cecil DeMille. Here is Miss Maria Michael, who was a student in Prague, Czechoslovakia, when the Nazis came.
Yes, and I saw the Czech flag over the president's castle come down slowly. A moment later, the Nazi swastika swung out proudly in its place. The occupation was on.
That was Czechoslovakia. And from Norway, we have Mr. Oka Fan.
I was in a concentration camp where I lost 24 pounds in 6 days. And every day there, I saw people beaten just at the whim of the Nazi guards.
Czechoslovakia, Norway, and from Poland, Miss Wanda Goretzka.
On the road eastward from Warsaw, I saw the highway chocked with refugees running to take shelter as the German planes swooped low and strafed.
Then the reports of the bad behavior of the Germans in the conquered countries are true.
In Poland, they were beastly.
In Norway, they were brutal.
In Czechoslovakia, they were sweet. They set up field kitchens to feed us. Of course, we had never starved until they came. And of course, the food they gave us was our own, stolen from us. And of course, we had to pay for it all over again. But it was sweet of them, by Nazi standards.
It was the same in Poland. I saw two German officers, whips in hand, waiting on a square to catch a Pole who would not take off his hat in passing them. A schoolboy refused to salute them, and they chased him down the street, whipping and kicking him.
In the concentration camp, they used to make all people run 10 steps, then fling themselves into the mud, then run again, then go down in the mud again. This went on for hours.
Mr. Fenn, wasn't it because of a play you wrote that they put you into a concentration camp?
Yes. But I liked it in the concentration camp.
Liked it? Why?
Because of the company. All the best people in Norway were there.
Speaking to you three makes me realize what the term United Nations means.
Yes, we are united against aggression and brutality. They couldn't crush our spirits in Norway.
Now in Poland, the occupation is a challenge to us, and meeting it, we know we will be victorious.
That's right. They say you can't live on ideas and ideals, but I saw people doing it.
Yes. And now that all of us have been united for 2 years, we're starting 1944 with the aggressors frightened. This is our year.
With us on What's New This Evening is one of Hollywood's most gracious gentlemen and finest actors, Herbert Morrison. With us on What's New This Evening is one of Hollywood's most gracious gentlemen and finest actors, Herbert Marshall. And appearing with Mr. Marshall will be one of the screen's newest leading ladies, Miss Evelyn Keyes. I take considerable personal pride in the rapid advancement of Miss Keyes to cinema stardom, for I gave her her first picture contract. But although I claim to be one of her discoverers, her accomplishments are due to her own beauty and very great ability. Ladies and gentlemen, we present Herbert Marshall and Evelyn Keyes with Donald Morrison in Milton Geiger's Lines for a Lady.
In the dressing room of Stephanie Carter, Broadway actress, a man is pacing to and fro nervously. He is Keith Bennett, husband of Stephanie Carter, and author of the play, which is in final rehearsal outside on the stage. There's a knock on the door. Keith Bennett looks up, a worried frown between his eyes.
Yes, come in. Oh, it's you, Rick. Come in.
I am in.
Sit down. Tell me, what do you think of my new play?
Well...
Oh, come now, out with it. This is business. You're in the business of dramatic criticism, just as I'm in the playwriting business, and Stephanie is in the acting business. Now then, how do you like the new play?
I didn't come to talk to you about the play, Keith.
No?
No. It's about, Stephanie.
Oh.
Cigarette, Keith?
Yes, thanks, yes. Well?
It's going to be awfully difficult for me to say. I don't know just how to go about it. You've all been such good friends.
Oh, come on, out with it.
I've been watching Stephanie lately.
Yes? So have I. But go on, go on.
I wanted to be sure, very sure. But tonight, watching her in a love scene with Barry Drake, I was sure. Keith, for your own sake, as well as hers, I wish you'd speak to her. Oh, confound it, I don't want to be brutal about it, but you know what I mean, don't you? You understand?
I'm afraid I do, Rick.
No offense, I hope.
No offense, no. I'm grateful. I've suspected it a long time. I'm not too greatly shocked.
Yes. Sorry, Keith, I thought you ought to know. And incidentally, it's not a bad play at all.
Thank you, Rex.
Not at all.
Well, what must be, must be. I have to come to this sooner or later.
Oh, Keith, weren't you up front?
No, Stephanie, I was not.
Is something the matter?
Should anything be the matter?
You look so solemn.
I want to talk to you.
All right. I like you to talk to me.
Stephanie. Why did I marry you?
Why, what a question, Keith.
Please answer.
You said you loved me.
And I did. You must have known that. Have you been happy?
Very happy indeed, Keith. And I'm grateful.
Are you, though? Are you?
I don't understand this at all.
Oh, you say you're grateful. I've made an actress out of you and all that. Yes. But are you sincere?
Please, please tell me what I've done to make you angry. I'm all at sea.
I'll tell you. The least you might have done was to have been loyal.
Loyal? But I've been loyal.
Then what about that
buried Drake out there.
What about him? He's my leading man, that's all.
You've been seeing him a great deal?
Well, naturally, he's my... We've been going over the... Oh, Keith, are you selected him yourself for the part?
Yes. How ironical.
You're making a terrible mistake.
I don't think so. Oh, come, Stephanie, I know something about the stage and play acting. I dare say you're very plausible and convincing, but this isn't a stage. This is life.
Oh, Keith, you must be quite mad or ill.
People are beginning to talk.
I don't care what they're beginning to do. I love you. You must believe that. You mustn't hurt us, though, Keith.
I don't want to hurt you. That's just it. I don't want to hurt you. But how am I to believe you? I want to believe you, but how?
I don't know what you mean.
Can't you see? You're an actress. How can I tell whether the truth leaves off and play acting begins with you? That's what's torturing me.
But if I say with all my heart and soul that I love you...
I'd like so much to believe you, but I can't.
Oh, what fantastic madness men think of.
It's madness enough for me. At night, I lie awake wondering, does she mean all those adorable things she says to me? Or is she acting? Am I the adored husband, or am I an audience bewitched by the beauty and art of a great actress? And I go mad.
But, Keith, darling, you say things too. And you're a writer. By the same insane logic, I might think... Does my adored husband mean the sweet soft things he whispers to me? Or am I an audience, listening to the empty phrases of a play? Summer tryout. Am I indeed his cherished wife, or am I an audience? You see how it works, Keith?
There's this one important difference. I'm not an actor. It's the playwright's art to put the things he wishes said aptly upon the player's lips. I can't give those words conviction, but you're different.
Because I happen to be an actress.
Because you happen to be an actress.
Very well, then. I'll prove my love for you, Keith. I will not be an actress, then.
You will not? What do you mean?
I mean that from this moment, I cease being an actress to be your wife, whose love you may trust and believe.
But, oh, no, Stephanie, you can't sacrifice your career like that for me. It's unthinkable.
My mind is made up.
But, love...
My mind is made up, Keith.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to tell my understudy that she'll play the part when we open tomorrow night. And forever after, for all I care. And now, kiss me, my husband.
Stephanie.
And now, goodbye for a moment. I'll be back to stay.
Oh, beg pardon, Stephanie.
That's all right. Go right in, Rex. Bye-bye.
Yes, Rex, do come in. What's on your mind now, old fella?
I had to come back. After I left you, I was horribly afraid that perhaps I hadn't been quite clear. Possibly I left the wrong impression about Stephanie.
I know that, Rex, but you wanted to make sure. You wanted to make me see that when you saw her tonight in her new role, your worst fears were confirmed. In brief, you were trying in your bumbling way to tell me that Stephanie cannot act worth a hoot, right?
Yes, precisely. Always suspected it. Tonight, when I saw those awful love scenes between her and Barry Drake, I was absolutely sure. Keith, she's hopeless.
Yes, Rex. I've just spoken to her about it.
Oh, poor girl. Must have been brutal. She always fancied herself a great actress, and now...
Compose yourself, my dear fellow. Stephanie has just decided, of her own free will, to leave the stage forever.
I know, Keith, but the pain, the anguish...
No anguish. Stephanie is giving up her career, secure and happy in the belief that she was a great actress.
Wonderful. What made her think so?
I told her so.
But how? Why?
It is the playwright's art to put the things he wishes said aptly upon the player's lips. Cigarette, Rex.
What's New? Presented by RCA, Radio Corporation of America, will continue with Cecil B. DeMille, Lena Horne, Jack Douglas, Herbert Marshall, Evelyn Keyes, Major General Ira Acre, Carlos Ramirez, Donald Morrison and Lou Bring and the RCA Victor Orchestra and Chorus after a brief pause for station identification.
This is Cecil B. DeMille continuing with What's New. And continuing, too, with Lena Horne singing Mad About the Boy.
about the boy. It's pretty funny, but I'm mad about the boy. He has a gay appeal that makes me feel there may be something sad about the boy. Walking down the street, his eyes look out at me from people that I meet. I can't believe it's true, but when I'm blue in some strange way, well, I'm glad about the boy. I'm hardly sentimental. Love isn't so sublime. I have to pay my rental, and I can't afford to waste much time. If I could employ a little magic, that would finally destroy this dream that pains me and enchains me, but I can't, because I'm mad about the boy. I'm hardly sentimental. And I can't afford to wait much time. If I could employ a little magic that would finally destroy this dream that pains me and enchains me, but I can't.
Thank you, Lena. On this January 1st, 1944, we face a new year. And almost before the new year begins, we face Jack Douglas. Well, leave us face it.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You'll have to excuse me because I have a very bad cold. Last night, somebody stole half of my pajamas. The warm half. The top. Well, here it is, New Year's Day, the morning after the night before, and everybody in Los Angeles is picking cotton out of aspirin bottles. And my uncle was doing all right last night. I wouldn't say he had too much to drink, but by 3 o'clock this morning, he was seeing pink H.P. Kaltenborns. And finally, after all these years, I discovered the birds and the bees. They're in my stomach. And New Year's Eve in Hollywood was really something. At 11 o'clock, the manager of the Owl drugstore went home and the owl took over. And at 12 o'clock, my babe couldn't even pick a pistol up. Mr. DeMille, do you mind if I ask you a personal question?
Not at all, Jack. What is it?
Well, everybody knows that your name is Cecil B. DeMille, but nobody knows what your middle initial B stands for. What does B stand for?
You really want to know?
Yes.
Roma salsa, Roma salsa, Roma salsa. Roma salsa.
Well, reap the wild wind. And before I go any further...
Hello, Jack.
Oh, hello, Mr. Marshall. How are things along Piccadilly?
Fine. How are things along Tobacco Road?
We moved. We now live out in the San Fernando Gully.
Jack, you don't mean gully. You mean valley.
During the rainy season?
Well, there's only one thing to do in rainy weather, and that's go to the movies.
Yeah, I saw a wonderful picture up at the Pantages. It's all about a Russian that rode a horse for 700 miles.
A Russian that rode a horse for 700 miles? What's the name of the picture?
Tender Comrade.
Jack, the things you say. Why, you're nothing but a... nothing but a... what is that refined word for jerk?
Nincompoop.
Oh, yes, yes. You're nothing but a nincompoop.
Fine place for a comma. Mr. Marshall, you're English, aren't you?
Well, if I'm not, why am I talking like Basil Rathbone?
Well, I'd like to ask you a question. What do they call a wolf in England?
A rotter.
Oh, a wolf in England is called a rotter, eh? That gives me an idea.
It does?
Yeah, let's go down to the corner of Hollywood and Vine and rot. How does that sound?
No good.
Well, I'll tell you, let's you and me go to the Palladium. I'll walk in right in back of you, and when you see a pretty girl, you wink at her, and I'll jump out and grab her. How does that sound?
Like a booby trap. No, Jack, no, that doesn't sound quite dignified enough.
Well, maybe I'll act like an Englishman, you know, cheerio and all that sort of thing.
You think you know how?
Oh, sure, I used to go around with an English girl, and here's her picture in a strapless bathing suit.
An English girl in a strapless bathing suit? How'd she keep it up?
Oh, cheerio and all that sort of thing. But you know, Mr. Marshall, I can't understand why the girls don't like me. After all, I use Lux Flaccus. I even use Life Boyer. But I wish I had a girl like Hedy Lamarr.
Jack, you're always talking about Hedy Lamarr. So what has she got that your girl hasn't got?
Well, nothing, but on Hedy, it don't look like flat tops. But you know, most of the pretty girls are working in defense factories all day long. How can I get to meet one of them?
Why don't you learn to cook?
Well, I can cook. I can make everything but donuts.
That's ridiculous. Donuts are very easy to make.
They are?
Sure. You just take a round piece of air and put a rethread on it.
That's all I have to know, and I'll do all right as a great lover, eh?
Yes, and just keep saying to yourself, life can be beautiful.
Life can be beautiful.
That's right.
Don't you think Esquire would be more fun?
Jack, you're going to drive me to drink.
I am?
Yes.
You know a place?
Really, the things you say. Have you had any education at all?
Oh, of course. I went to Vassar.
Jack, for your information, Vassar is a girl's school.
You mean I shouldn't have played hooky? But you can't blame me for what I am today, Mr. Marshall. Did you know that I was born on New Year's Eve in a cocktail lounge?
You were born in a cocktail lounge? Oh. Did the stork bring you?
No, stool pigeon. But I had a tough time when I was a baby. My mother didn't like me. She wouldn't even come near me.
She wouldn't?
No, in fact, she used to pin me up by radar. I don't know what that means either. But in all fairness to my folks, I must say, every time I got sick, they gave me the best of care.
Did they call in a good medical man?
Well, he wasn't exactly a medical man. He drove a truck for Dr. Pepper.
Jack, tell me, when you were a baby, did you suck your thumb?
Sure, and I still do.
Why?
Can't find my ration book. But you like children, don't you, Mr. Marshall?
Sure, here's a picture of my niece. It was taken when she was a little baby. And just for novelty, we put her in a kangaroo's pouch with the little kangaroo, see?
Well, I see the kangaroo's pouch, and I see the little kangaroo, but I don't see your niece.
Did that little son of a gun throw out again? Don't you think that's exciting?
Well, it's not as exciting as what happened to my father last night. My father thought he was a dive bomber, and he jumped off the top of the city hall.
Your father thought he was a dive bomber, and he jumped off the top of the city hall?
Yes, and that's how my uncle got hurt.
How?
He was the tail gunner. And that brings us to our social problem for the night. Ladies and gentlemen, don't let liquor ruin your life. Let it ruin mine.
what's new in methods for better cooperation between labor and management. In New York today, with Jim Ameche, are two people who can tell you what's new. Go ahead, Jim Ameche.
Sitting across from me are Mr. Samuel Klein, vice president of the Mary Moffat Junior Dress Company of St. Louis, and chairman of the board of directors of the Associated Garment Industries of St. Louis, and Mrs. Isabel Southern, staff representative of the Management Engineering Department, International Ladies Garment Workers Union. Mrs. Southern, your union is in the ladies' garment field.
That's right. The International Ladies Garment Workers Union is a labor organization of our state who makes clothing for America's women. Although these days, they're just as apt to be making parachutes and other war items.
And, Mr. Klein, your factory is one of these ILGWU shops.
Yes, and we're happy about our joint accomplishments at Mary Moffat. We're constantly striving to improve the standards of our manufacturing methods. So we telephoned the Management Engineering Department of the union and asked them to send us one of their engineers.
Engineers in a union?
Yes, our union maintains a staff of trained industrial engineers and technicians. We furnish a consulting service free of charge to manufacturers in contractual relationships with our organization.
Well, a couple of the department's engineers came down to St. Louis. They analyzed our factory's production procedures and helped us improve them.
And then Mr. Perlstein, the original vice president of the union, came across with the idea that these people who worked in the Mary Moffat shop were the very ones who ought to know the most about the factory's problems. We began to gather suggestions from them. One of the first was to set up what we now call our Labor Management Council.
Has this Labor Management Council actually helped you?
I'll say it has. The council considers matters surrounding working conditions in the shop. It became very interested in a couple of devices which it felt would make the Mary Moffat shop a more agreeable place in which to work. One of those devices was industrial color. We did the whole place over in scientifically selected color combinations. We even painted the machines. Now our factory is not only a more cheerful place, the color has eliminated glare and therefore eye strain. Believe me, the council proved to us that a more agreeable place in which to work means a more efficient place.
And then they began to think about the problems of monotony and fatigue, two big factors in any needle trade shop. A music system was installed by the Radio Corporation of America. The music used throughout the working day is carefully chosen. Programs are presented with a definite objective of furnishing an unobtrusive background of music, which will assist in relaxing tired minds and hands without distracting attention from work.
What reaction have you had to this use of color and music, Mr. Klein?
Well, naturally, the reaction has been a good one.
Thank you, Mrs. Southern and Mr. Klein.
Remembered joys are never past, especially when memories are described in beautiful songs. Songs like I'll Remember April, which Rubring and the RCA Victor Orchestra play for us now.
This lovely day will lengthen into evening. This goodbye to all we've ever had.
moment, you will hear the voice of General Ira Acre, commanding officer of the United States Army 8th Air Force Bomber Command, from somewhere in England. While our engineers are making contact, I'd like to mention that among those with particular interest in what General Acre has to say is Mr. DeMille himself. Our host happens to be one of our original aviation enthusiasts, and among other things, he organized and operated the first commercial airline in the United States. Isn't that correct, C.B.?
Well, when you say you're the first in anything, you always start an argument. But I started the Mercury Aviation Company back in 1917.
Where did it operate?
From Los Angeles to San Francisco, stopping at Bakersfield. And from Los Angeles to San Diego. We had 7 airfields. And I remember such flyers as Eddie Rickenbacker, Jimmy Doolittle, and General Arnold dropping in on us.
What kind
of... And in those days, it was really dropping in.
What kind of planes did you have?
Well, we started out with two-place Jennies until we branched out with bigger jobs. And as one of the pilots, I'm still mighty proud of our record of flying 25,000 passengers in such medieval equipment from 1917 to 1923 without an accident.
When you said as one of the pilots, did you mean you flew the planes yourself?
Yes, Ralph. That's the reason why Mercury Aviation was organized. I tried to enlist in the Air Corps during World War I, but they turned me down.
Why was that?
Said I was too old. But I wanted to fly, so I bought a cracked-up Canadian Jenny and took lessons. I flew passengers for Mercury in that ship.
Well, do you still have the same enthusiasm for flying after all these years?
I certainly do. I have an even greater interest right now because my son, Private Richard DeMille, and my son-in-law, Major Joseph Harper, are both members of the United States Army Air Forces. And I wouldn't mind getting in myself, but after 26 years, I'm afraid they'd turn me down again.
Too old?
No, too young.
Well, I think the engineers are ready with England now. C.B., will you take over?
Yes, Ralph. Ladies and gentlemen, we take you to London, where you will hear from an officer who nearly 2 years ago, in February 1942, arrived in England in command of the first increment of the 8th Air Force. He built up and commanded the 8th Bomber Command until December 1942, when he became commanding general of the 8th Air Force. He has been responsible for proving the case for daylight precision bombing in Europe. We hear him on the eve of his departure to succeed Air Chief Marshal Tedder as Commander-in-Chief of the Allied Air Forces in the Mediterranean. Ladies and gentlemen, we present Lieutenant General Ira C. Acre.
In the last 2 days, the 8th Air Force has seen the old year out by mounting its greatest aerial attacks against Hitler's Europe. On each of these days, more than 1,500 American airplanes attacked the continent from England. More than half of them were four-engine bombers. For our first raid against Germany, made in January of last year, our best effort was less than 100 bombers. At the beginning of a new year, it is pardonable to summarize our progress during the previous 12 months and to express our thanks to those responsible. We are grateful, first of all, to the workers in America who have manufactured our superb airplanes and their cargoes of bombs and ammunition we now consume in tremendous quantities. We pay tribute also to the small group of American airmen who, long before the war, developed the American concept of daylight precision bombing, which has been triumphantly vindicated in 1943. But most of all, the achievement of the 8th Air Force is due to the intrepid gallantry of our combat crews and the heroic drudgery of our maintenance men. I am very proud, and everyone in America should be proud as well, of what these fighting men of ours have done. The flyers of the 8th Bomber Command were the first Americans privileged to bring the war to Germany. They have penetrated as deeply as 800 miles into Germany to find, hit, and destroy Hitler's most important war factories. The men of the 8th Fighter Command were the first Allied flyers to put fighter planes into Germany and over Germany herself. Using long-range tanks, they have escorted our bombers to Kiel, Bremen, the Ruhr, and many other targets in Germany, meeting the Hun on his home ground and destroying his best fighters at the rate of better than 3-1. These men are fighting the toughest aerial war the world has ever seen. Facing them are nearly 70% of Germany's fighters, more than double the number on the Russian and Mediterranean fronts combined. At the high altitudes where our formations normally fly, the temperature is often 50 degrees below zero. If a gunner takes his hand out of his glove for over 2 minutes, he is likely to lose fingers from frostbite. If he takes his oxygen mask off for 2 minutes, he dies. It is a grim struggle. It taxes human endurance and fortitude to the limit. Yet, despite the most desperate defenses that the Germans can devise, The men of the 8th Air Force have never been turned away from a single target by enemy action. The 8th Air Force began operations from one British airfield. Now we have more than 100. During the past year, we have dispatched 64,000 offensive sorties over the continent and destroyed 4,100 German fighters and dropped 55,000 tons of bombs on Nazi targets. We have inflicted vital damage on Germany's ability to wage war. One example will suffice. Since July, the 8th Air Force has cut Germany's planned fighter production by nearly 40%. Despite our tough battles, our overall loss rate has not been high. Less than 4% of our heavy bombers have failed to return. I know of no happier omen for 1944 than to point that our rapid growth would never have been possible without the cooperation and the unstinted help of the Royal Air Force and the generous hospitality and kindly encouragement of the whole British people. There is enthusiasm here for our task, a fighting spirit and high morale as we face our great air battle, for the goal is in sight. All the men of the 8th Air Force are proud that 1944 will see them going forward in full partnership with the Royal Air Force and the Allied land and sea forces to victory.
Good luck, General Acre, and the best of everything for the new year to you and your gallant men. We'll be back next Saturday when RCA, the Radio Corporation of America, again presents What's New with Dinah Shaw, Jack Douglas, Bob Crosby, Les Tremaine, Dorothy Lundgren, and the RCA Victor Orchestra, and from New York, Dudley Diggs, and the cast of the Broadway dramatic hit, Listen, Professor. Until then, this is Cecil B. DeMille saying good night to you from Hollywood.
Herbert Marshall will soon be seen in Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer's Andy Hardy's Blonde Trouble. Carlos Ramirez appears through the courtesy of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, producer to the Technicolor Thousands Cheer. Evelyn Keyes will shortly be seen in the Columbia picture, Nine Girls. The appearance of Army personnel on this program does not constitute an endorsement of the product advertised.